Let thankful songs and tongues of joy, O bless and magnify his name. Good morning, brothers and sisters, and welcome to our morning service. And we are so happy to have you here. Lord, I want to welcome those who are watching or listening by social media this morning, and ask that as we go through this service, that the sermon or something that you hear will touch your heart and bless your soul. Please stand for the call to worship. Come to worship this day. Bring with you all your joys and sorrows.
Jesus is our hope.
Come to worship this day, believing in the power of God through Jesus Christ.
Jesus will bring us healing.
Come to worship this day, feeling the presence of God.
Jesus will teach us new ways today.
Amen.
Amen. Please be seated and let us go to our Lord and Savior in prayer. Eternally loving and gracious Father, we humble ourselves before you this morning for this, the last day of Black History Month, the last day of February, as well as the last Sunday of the month, to honor you and praise you. We thank you for your guidance and direction throughout this month and for the blessings you have bestowed on us during this time. Thank you for who you are and for our brothers and sisters who you have blessed with ingenious minds, gifts, and talents, for the tools and resources that they have invented that we depend on daily so we can go through life's direction. Because of all this, Lord, we are so grateful. We thank you, O God, for your continued grace and mercies, and ask, O God, that you be our strength and our guide. Speak through your servant and the one you have chosen to lead this flock who will proclaim the word this morning. And we ask all these in the precious name of your Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Let us repeat the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
I need you. You need me. We are all a part of God's body. Stand with me. Agree with me. We are all a part of God's body. It is His will that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. Good morning, children. A happy Sunday morning to you. I feel truly blessed this morning to be here. My talk this morning is mostly for the parents. And children, you are also involved. I was watching Channel 12 this morning, and I saw something very pathetic. There was this young miss walking along, and then the news said she left a little girl behind. Then I saw the little girl coming. She was about 8 years old, and they found the little girl abandoned. Parents, I know it is very stressful. Parents who are listening, it is very stressful. But please, get somebody to help you to take care of the children. So I decided this morning that I'm going to make an appeal to parents to bring the children here on Saturday, this Saturday. I will get them moving. I am 76 years old, but as Reverend Edwards, I can move. I will get them moving. We have enough space to practice social distancing. We have masks. We can get hand washing done. We can get sanitization done. We can do anything that will keep them surviving this stressful time. So parents, my appeal to you is to call me on Friday so I can know how many children can make it here. And the teenagers, I may need help. So don't be telling me that you're not a child. So you come here, and Saturday we have enough space to practice social distancing. And parents listening to me now, we're going to need lunch. So I would like to know how many children will be here Saturday so I can make the appeal, and you bring me something or call me, tell me you will put together and cook something, buy something, and bring them lunch. Because the children need us to survive. So I pray for you. You pray for me. I'm going to need prayer Saturday. I love you. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you. I need you to survive. Amen? Amen? And thank you ahead of time. Amen. We will now hear Brother Gums and the steel pan as he ministers to us. Thank you.
Thank God for the gift of music. COVID cannot stop our music.
That's right.
Amen. This is the time to minister unto the Lord in our, by our giving. We want to thank those who have been doing it online and those who have been doing it by post. If you have not given it this morning, there's an opportunity for you to do so when you will be leaving. Please don't go home with it. It is the Lord's. So give it to Him and you will be blessed. And for those who are at home, we want to encourage you to set something apart if you've not done it so, so that you can send it to the church. The ministry of the church doesn't stop. Thank you. Glorify you because you heard our prayer morning down. We thank you for the vaccines. We thank you for all the help we are receiving. Our help comes from you. We recognize this and we say thank you. Accept our thanks and our praises, and for what we have gathered, help us so we will use it thoughtfully and wisely for the furtherance of your kingdom on earth. This is our prayer, and we know you have blessed us because we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Let's turn to our bulletin, and let's have the first lesson read. The first lesson is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 17. I will read the first seven verses, and then jump to verse 15, and read verse 15 and 16. Genesis chapter 17, verse 1 through 7, and 15 through 16. I read, when Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abraham and said to him, I am God Almighty, walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abraham fell on his face, and God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abraham, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and your offspring after you throughout their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be God to you and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, as for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of people shall come from her. May the Lord bless his words into our hearts.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel. And this is found in St. Mark chapter 8, verses 31 through 38. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at the disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, if anyone and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. God bless the reading of his holy word this morning. Will the congregation please be seated? And we have Sister Paula this morning will minister to us in song.
Waiting time, you're supposed to be praying in the waiting time. So I ask you to focus your mind and pray that everything comes together for the Father.
Ah, okay. Pray for me. Come on, I'm sorry, guys. I'm sorry. There we go. Okay, let me start over.
Thank you.
song has always intrigued me, especially when it says, God is watching you from a distance. I'm one of those who believe that God watches us up close. And if we understand that God watches us up close, it gives us a different feel as per our culpability in the suffering that we witness and the suffering that we ourselves perpetrate. But then as I hear you sing it, I hear this song in a different light. It's always good to look at things from a distance because they look okay. But when you get up close, the reality strikes you and strikes you in a way that disrupts your peace or interrupts your calm. So God is watching you from a distance. He's watching how you react, how you take things that are happening. So I thank you for that witness, Sister Paula. So the title, Good Morning, Brothers and Sisters. Grace and peace be to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And so the title of the message this morning is Becoming a Follower of Jesus. Becoming a Follower of Jesus. And the text is Mark chapter 8, verses 31 to 38. Mark chapter 8, verses 31 to 38. And let me just read a few of these verses in your hearing to help us focus our thoughts and our hearts to receive this word. Verse 34. He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, if any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. Here is the question. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Let us pray to God. Lord God, speak to us in the quietness of this time while we wait on you. Speak, Lord, by touch of tongue and by touch of life. And so let your word be spoken, let your word, O God, be heard, and then let your word be lived. And so let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. You know, crowds were always following Jesus around. No matter where he went, he might have wanted some private time. But as he went, crowds seemed always to be following him around. And we might ask, why is it that they might be doing that? Why is it crowds were following him? Was it that they were looking for the spectacular? Was it that they were looking for the noteworthy? Was it that they were looking to see miracles happen? Why were they following him around? For whatever the reason, we know that they were following him around.
Yet not everyone who was following Jesus around was a follower of Jesus. Let me say that again. Even though crowds were following him around, not everyone who was following Jesus around was a follower of Jesus. And so Jesus always took care to separate those who were following him around from those who were followers of his. Now I want you to know that this doesn't just simply apply to the crowd. It applies to the disciples too. And look at how Jesus responded to Peter in our text. Jesus was teaching them about what would happen to the Son of Man. He must undergo suffering. He's going to be rejected. He's going to be killed. And Peter took exception to that. And what Peter did was to take Jesus aside and rebuke Jesus. So even though it might have appeared as if Peter was a follower of Jesus, in that instance, Peter was just following Jesus around. So we who come to church might think that because we do come to church, and it's a good thing, that we are followers of Jesus. Jesus, as I said earlier on, was careful to separate the followers of his from those who were following him around. How did Jesus do that in our text? He did that by what I call the DCF. DCF of Jesus' strategy. The DCF of Jesus' strategy. Deny, take up your cross, and follow me. So we're going to look at each one of these and measure ourselves against that backdrop. The Greek word from which the English word deny comes from, or translate, is a word that meant no. So if you deny something, you say no to the thing. Or you refuse the thing. Or you reject it. Or you disown it. Or you oppose it. So when somebody says something about you and you know it's not true, you deny it. You say, no, I didn't do that. I refused that. I reject it, I disown it, I oppose it. And you know, Jesus demonstrated this for us by his own example. Jesus in the wilderness with the devil. The devil came tempting Jesus. Turn these stones into bread if you are that hungry. Some of us might see that as just simply a hunger thing. But for Jesus, it was an economic thing. Am I going to get folk to follow me simply because I'm able to provide for them on an economic level? If I'm able to give them money, and you know the stimulus stuff is coming. And some of us might choose to follow based upon whether or not we receive that check for $1,400. For Jesus, it wasn't about the economics. He denied, he refused the stone bread dynamic. He denied himself the opportunity to address his hunger. But then you will remember that the devil took him up on a high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and said to him, all of these will be yours if you worship me. And what Jesus said? Not happening. He could have been a political messiah. But he denied that. He refused that. He rejected that view. Because he knew that already they were all his. And so he didn't have to demonstrate in any way what really was his. People could follow me because I have political power. But that's not what Jesus was about. He disowned that kind of messiahship. And so the next thing that the devil did was to take him to familiar places, took him into the temple and took him up on the high pinnacle and said, if you cast yourself down, guess what's going to happen? The angels are going to just swoop in and catch you before you hit the ground. The magical messiah. The one who can conjure up angels, call them up. And they come at the right time to do him service. But Jesus said, no, not me, that's not me. So he rejected that, he opposed that view. He said, no. And each one of us must come to that place in our lives when we are able to say no to self if we are going to be a follower of Jesus. We, like Jesus, must say no to the desires that seem always to come up for us. The things that we feel would cause our lives to be more fulfilling. We need to be able to say no so that we can say yes to Jesus. Many a times we might try to do both. But again, Jesus reminds us that we can't serve two masters. Or we will love the one and hate the other. So he asks of us who would be followers of his that we must deny ourselves. Denial of self must become the hallmark of our lives. The demonstration that we are giving ourselves to Jesus and what he stands for, what he teaches, and what he expects of us. Jesus is not looking for persons who are willing to follow him around. He's looking for persons who are determined to become his followers. Persons who are committed to him. Persons who will live out the mandate of his message. Now, these are difficult times. And when we have difficult and challenging times, we tend to go with the flow. And we try to get what we can so that we'll be all right, we'll be comfortable. And here Jesus is saying that is not what he's calling us to. He's calling us to a life that is dedicated to him. So we must learn what it means to deny ourselves if we would become disciples or followers of Jesus. But Jesus not only said that, you must deny yourself, that's the D. But he next says that you must take up your cross. You know, we have this tendency to sometimes look at what we experience and say, well, this is the cross I must bear. You know, this is the cross I must carry. As if somehow God is giving us burdens to bear. It might be a relationship we have with someone that is a little burdensome or a little irritating, and we might say, well, this is what I have to bear. This is what I have to carry. This is what life is up to. Or it might be the job that we have, and we say, you know, this job I have is the cross I must bear, the cross I must carry in order to survive. That's not what Jesus meant when he says that each one of us must take up our cross. You know, in these days, it's fanciful to wear crosses, you know. Everybody's wearing a cross. But that's not what Jesus meant either. You see, in Jesus' day, a cross meant suffering. A cross meant death. A cross meant humiliation. So when Jesus was talking about taking up your cross, what Jesus was saying is that you must be willing to die for that which you say you believe in. You must be willing to put your life on the line for the one in whom you believe. What he was saying is that each one of us must be willing to die. Die to self by denying ourselves. Die to self so that we can follow him. In other words, then we cannot follow Jesus unless we have become dead to ourselves. In another way, we have to become indifferent to ourselves. But you know, as I reflected some more upon this particular statement, take up your cross, what I was hearing in the midst of that is that no one else is responsible but you. You know, some of us will say that I will die because I'm following Jesus. No, you will die because you make the decision to follow Jesus. In other words, then, you die for the decision you make, not for the one you follow. So it's on you. And to take up your cross is to take up your cross because you believe in the one for whom you take up the cross. But he's not responsible for the punishment or the persecution or the execution that comes to you. And again, Jesus demonstrated that. He carried his cross, he stumbled and he fell. And for him, that was his due. And yes, we can romanticize the cross in our time and say it's because he had to die for us. He had to die for our sins. He had to die so that we can experience salvation. So then, what are you going to die for? You can romanticize his suffering, his death. But truth be told, what are you going to die for? What are you willing to die for? What is your cross to take up? If for no other reason, this season of Lent should remind us that we should not only deny ourselves, but we must be willing to die for that for which we believe and the one in whom we believe. And the onus will be only on us, no one else. No one else. Just us. Just us. So we have the D, denial. We have the C, cross. Take up your cross. And now we have follow me. You see, what Jesus meant when he said to follow me was to commit yourself to him and only to him, you know. But let me just pause long enough to point out another peculiarity of the Greek. The word translated and, kai, K-A-I, kai, was not only a conjunction that connected two things. It's a word that also meant that is. You know, for us, and mean, you know, the phone, the mic, and the candles. All things in church this morning. But here, if you look closely, what Jesus was saying to those who would be followers of his, he was saying, you must deny yourself, take up your cross, that is, follow me. Put another way, if you deny yourself and take up your cross, then and only then are you freed up to follow me. You see, to follow Jesus meant to live out all that Jesus stood for and died for. To follow Jesus meant to live up to his expectations and to live out what he asks of us. So it's not just simply walking along. Literally, it means to live along. And so it wasn't enough for persons to follow Jesus around. And so we have to look at ourselves and ask ourselves, what am I doing? Am I just simply following Jesus around? Am I just associating myself with this Jesus movement? Hoping that I'm able to read the tea leaves and recognize when he's coming and then at that point give myself to him. The funny thing about life is that nothing is certain. And in a heartbeat, it could all end. It could all end. My mother used to say to us, you better know your scriptures and you better pray them. Because all the opportunity you might have is to say, Lord, have mercy. You see it happen ever so often. People standing on the subway platform and someone just nudges them over and they drop right in front of a train. All they have, Lord, have mercy. Or you are on your cell phone and you're walking and not noticing where you're going and you're right in the path of a car and if the driver wasn't alert, you would be gone in the wink of an eye. So you want to be a follower of Jesus? That's what you mean? That's what you want? If you want to become a follower of Jesus, then you must be willing to deny yourself. Say no to yourself. You must be willing to take up your cross. You must be willing to die. Die. Must be willing to be humiliated for that in which you believe or that in whom you believe. So you have to take up your cross and you have to follow Jesus. You have to give yourselves to him every day, every moment of your life. It's hard, but it's worth it. When all is said and done, what will you profit if you gain the whole world and lose your life? May God help us to come to terms with our own cautiousness, with our own tentativeness, so that God can have God's way with us. Not from a distance, but up close. In the name of the Father and of the Son
and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let us pray to God.
Praise God.
Lord, in these times, times that are challenging, times that are uncertain, times that bring intrigue, and times that are accompanied with fear and trembling. Yet, Lord, we come opening up ourselves to you, entrusting ourselves to you, depending upon you, God, to be God to us, so that you can bind up our broken hearts, that you'll hold us together so that we don't fall apart, that even in the midst of these times of isolation, that we'll have deep connections with you, connections that sustain our lives, connections that fuel our lives, connections that make life purposeful and meaningful. Come alongside us, we pray, and nudge us, O God, in the direction we need to go, so that we can follow you and not just follow you around. Give us the courage, O God, to cut ourselves free from the things that are about us, so that we can busy ourselves with the things of God. Come, Lord Jesus, we pray. Come, Lord Jesus, we ask. An answer to the stirrings of our hearts, where when we experience illness in our bodies or in our minds or in our emotions or wherever we experience illness or brokenness, O God, we ask that you hold us together and give us wholeness. Give us the healing we need so that we can be restored. Not just our bodies, Lord, but our minds and our emotions. Lord, we ask you to heal our broken relationships. Heal us at those places where we are weakest. Heal us, bind us, strengthen us, O God, where we might feel as if we have no connection with others. These are times, O God, of severe aloneness that can breed loneliness, that might result in depression, not just for us older folk, but also for the young, the children, the young people. Lord, we ask you to break into their lives and give them the resources they need, not just to survive, but to thrive, and to thrive knowing that you walk beside them even in their darkest moments. You are shining your light, O God, because you refuse to leave them alone. And then, O God, we ask you to send us on our way so that we in turn can become the lights in a world that is so dark, the encouragement in a life that is so fearful, and the dependable in a life that is so undependable, so uncertain, that we will become your presence, Lord, wherever we find ourselves. And because of that, we will become your hope, your peace, and your love. And we ask you these things in the name of your Son, our salvation, Jesus Christ. And God's people say,
Amen.
Amen. Just want to quickly bring to your attention some opportunities for ministry. Know that this Lent,
We're still having those services as we usually would have for the cluster. Last Wednesday, we had the first Lenten service that was hosted by Co-op City. We know the preacher was the Reverend Annette Rodriguez. So this Wednesday coming, it will be hosted by Calvary United Methodist Church, and the preacher or leader for that worship service, that time of fellowship together, will be the Reverend Wesley Daniel. Now, all of these services begin at 7 and they are carried via Zoom. So in the bulletins, you have the ID that you sign on with, and that is 923-9074-4028. 923-9074-4028. 7 p.m. The services are carried. Not only that, but I need to remind the seniors that starting on the 8th of March, that's the second Monday in this month of March, and every second Monday subsequent, that there will be a meeting. And my memory tells me it starts at 12, right? Now, if it's not 12, you will get the correction next week. But the seniors will gather by conference call going forward, and I trust that all of us who are above 50 will connect with the seniors. I really hope we do, so that we can encourage as well and support. There's always strength in numbers, this year, no? Also, you will see in the bulletin the registration form for the Metropolitan District United Methodist Women's 41st Annual Communion Brunch. That's on the 5th. So bear that in mind, brothers and sisters. That's the deadline, right? The deadline for that brunch. The brunch will be held on the 13th of March. It will be held via Zoom, so you're encouraged to bear that in mind. I remind you that you should pray for those who are sick. This week we learned that Brother Paul Thomas was discharged from the hospital. And so now you can call him and encourage him at home. Also, during the course of this week, we heard that Naila Jacobs, Sister Vicky Jacobs' daughter, Shane's mom, was ill, fallen ill. And so we are encouraging all of us to lift her up in prayer, asking God to restore her and to restore her quickly. You know, we continue to pray for Brother Dwayne Williams, pray for Major Addison, pray for Sister Phyllis Watson, pray that Sister Renee continue to improve and be restored. We also pray for Tommy Douglas, the mother of Deaconess Minister Linda Douglas Smith. And we remember all those who have lost loved ones in this COVID time. So we ask God to continue to comfort them and to assure them that they will get through these times empowered. In March, this first week, there are at least four persons who will be celebrating birthdays, and I encourage you on those days to lift them up. Monday, March the 1st, Sister Simonetta Drew. Tuesday, March the 2nd, Sister Maria Connor, March the 6th, Saturday, Alexandra Rogers, and also on Saturday, March the 6th, Sister Angela Robinson Staley. So we continue to lift these persons up in our prayers. Also remember to support the project, the mission project we have, trying to get tablets purchased for students in Jamaica, Kensington Mansion Hill Methodist Circuit. And we recall that because of the unavailability of tablets, they gather around one tablet to do their work together. So 10 students, 10 tablets have been sponsored. And so you can give, you can call up Reverend Fairweather and let her know that you're making a donation. Send the donation to her or send it through the church and she will receive that donation. Want to thank all those who were online on Zoom yesterday when we had our Black History Month celebration. Want to thank all those who participated. You know, Brother Gums, while I was sitting there, I said to myself, it was really grievous, you know, Reverend Fairweather, that we didn't reach out to Brother Gums to play steel pan. But we thank God that he played the steel pan the way he did this morning.
Yeah.
As if to say, you know, I didn't include me in the celebration, so we're going to include myself here in church. But I was really feeling your absence from that celebration. So we'll never do that again.
Never.
Never, ever, ever. And we started out with the call of the drums, Brother Roland. Brother Roland was playing the drums and we started out with that. And then we went into the rest of the celebration. Want to thank those who did poetry or dramatic presentation or speeches or what have you. Want to thank you for your contribution to that experience. The experience was, from what I have been hearing from persons, have been top class. I haven't forgotten, Reverend Fred, I have that right here. So we had Black History Celebration. Now, next door, in the classroom next to this worship space, is what is called a chat room. You know, people come to church and go straight home. That's good. Go check out the chat room. You see the history of Black folks, primarily in this country, but beyond this country as well. So I'm encouraging you to stay so that you can go see the, get the experience of the chat room. Reverend Fairweather is very disappointed that she and two or three others have gone through the process of mounting this history on the walls, and persons come to church and go away and they're even look. If you could see her underneath her mask, you would see how upset she is. So I'm encouraging you to go and check that out. Also, the upper room disciplines. We encourage you to still do that, still get those upper room disciplines. They're still available. This is the year-long one. So bear that in mind, brothers and sisters. Now, next month, starting tomorrow, is Women's History Month. And in March, then, we'll be celebrating not only the presence, but the history making of women. And so from Sunday to Sunday, Sunday beginning first Sunday to the end of March, only women will be preaching. So what does that mean? Don't expect me to be up here.
Even if I put on African outfit, it doesn't mean anything other than I'm identifying with my heritage. So we encourage you to come out to worship. We have preachers lined up for the entire month of August, of March.
It's not me.
No, you don't understand. What my body is telling me is that I am due a vacation. So in August is vacation month, but in March we have Women History Month. And so we encourage you to come out to be in solidarity with the women. I forget what that was, what the theme is. I don't remember the theme, the theme. So be that as it may. You will know what the theme is by next Sunday. If I can quickly do that, I'll tell you. If I don't see it here, then I don't see it. Okay. The theme for Women's History Month will be God uses unlikely people for his purpose. God uses unlikely people for his purpose. And the passage that is really of consequence here is the passage referencing Ruth. So, read up all you can about Ruth in, and Boaz, and not primarily Ruth. No? So bear that in mind, brothers and sisters. God uses unlikely people for his purpose. Want to also at this time welcome all who have come, some for the first time since COVID. Want to thank you for coming. It's always good to see young people in church, no? Right, Sister Chelsea? We know we have seen both Hassani and his sister. I'm being deliberate because she's not looking up at me. But Chelsea, we are happy to see you today. And we're just happy that Lumley decided to make sure that you're on her left side. So we're happy to see you, church. Is this, I see a person, you know, this is the funny thing with masks. You don't know who are behind the mask. I want to say it's Usha, but who knows? I want to say it's, Miss George, but who knows? You know, you look at persons and you don't know anymore unless they bring their mask down, you don't know, right? But I want to welcome everybody, including you, Sister Richards. You know, Sister Richards is identifiable. Not everybody has that advantage, but I welcome you, Sister Richards, and everyone else who came. If I didn't call it by name, it's because the mask is hiding. Okay? But know that you're all welcome, sir. And yes, we do encourage you to take the vaccine. The more of us take the vaccine, the safer the rest of us will be from serious illness or even death. So if you need to be connected with somebody so that you can get the vaccine, call Rev Gordon. She has an inside line to getting the vaccine. So bear that in mind. Am I forgetting anything other than thanking those who participated and led the worship? Want to thank Brother Roland, Minister Savage, Brother Gums, Sister Paula, for the ministry of music that he provided. Want to thank Rev Freeman, Minister Benjamin, Minister Alabisi for their part in leading this worship service. I want to thank the ushers for
their role in seeing to that we were properly seated. Thank you. I know you're doubling us, both trustee and usher. But thank you as well, Brother Saunders. I want to thank Brother Cleveland for sanitizing the space so that we can worship in peace. If you haven't, remember to drop your offering when you are coming in. There's a basket in the front for you to do that as we leave. Remember, the chat room is next door, and you're encouraged to participate in that experience. And in addition to all of this, have a most blessed rest of February. And see you in March. I invite you then to stand to receive the benediction. Brothers and sisters, I invite you to live as God called you to live. Don't just follow Jesus around in your mind or in your heart. Become a follower of Jesus, remembering that you have to deny yourself, to take up your cross, and to follow him. In truth, what would it profit you to gain the whole world and then to lose your life? And so I pray that God the Father, who loves and takes care of you, God the Son, who redeems you by his life, death, and resurrection, and the Holy Spirit, who continues to give life to you and to me, may God meet you today and every moment of your life. Amen. Now go in peace to serve the Lord. Thank you.
Jesus.